So I'm going to do a presentation about, I'm going to try to illustrate the benefits of fast data in the context of XVA computing. So first, I will try to describe what is XVA really quickly. Then I will show you how XVA's need for speed, scale, and accuracy implies a reorganization of the software design around what I name the database analytics and visualization triptych. And finally, I give some insight on how we can integrate GPU in-memory database to leverage XVA analytics. So I'm Assad Bouayoun, and I worked as a quant for the last 15 years in different investment banks. After having written a prototype of XVA systems using massively distributed design and with GPUs, I'm now participating to its productionization. Sorry for the accent. So what is... So that's also important, and what I'm saying here is only between us. So what is XVA? So XVA is an extension of classical derivative pricing theory. It enables a more realistic approach to financial risk management, including counterparty and funding risks. This approach can be generalized to any type of financial contracts or other type of contracts, actually. So XVA is about including into the value of a particular contract, portfolio or business unit, the expected value, costs or benefits of the counterparty risk, so we name that CVA, the funding risk, we name that FVA, the funding of the margin, which is the MVA, the funding of the regulatory capital, the KVA, and also we can add a lot of other value adjustments. So what is important here is to realize that the way we used to compute the value of a portfolio was not correct because it didn't include a lot of different risks. Okay, so with this approach, we've got a more realistic view of the break-even of the business. So when we do this, obviously, we compute these values, but also the risk associated to these values. So here, just to give you the scale of these numbers, I showed you a table where you can see per bank. So you don't have my bank, but it's not far from these numbers. We can see that you've got 20 billion of CVAs for the biggest European and US banks. So you need to manage this amount of money. It's quite challenging. The building block of XVA is what we name the simulated exposure. It's the value of the contract or of the portfolio of or the collection of all the portfolios at a particular time for a particular simulation. So we compute this value and also the first and the second derivatives. We do this because we want to hedge. So we want to be able to buy financial products to offset the risk, swaps, cross-currency swaps, CDSs as well. We need this also to compute the provisions, so the size of the unexpected loss. We also need to do this to do some optimization and to try to find the best new trade that minimize the cost part of the XVA. We also need this to do some stress testing by computing the XVA for extreme values of market data, for example, interest rates. And we also start to do some reverse stress testing where we find the scenario that provokes the worst outcome. So how the need for speed, scale, and accuracy implies a reorganization of the software design? So you need to understand that in order to compute that XVA, we need a lot of data coming from a lot of different systems in the bank. We need to have, obviously, a lot of market data, but also all the trade data and all the counterparty data. So it's a little bit like federating all the data in the bank. So it's a big a task. We need also to standardize them. So that's the input. The outputs are represented here. So it's a kind of cascade where from the input, the trades, and the counterparty data, we can compute the base future mark-to-market, which are actually the simulated exposure I was talking about. We can shift, we can compute the risk, and then we've got the risk future mark-to-market, and then you can see that we go down. Everything which is in green is XVA specific, but you can see that you've got other metrics like the PV, the present value, the VAR, the SVAR, that are not XVA specific, and that could be computed for a derivative desk, for example, or for other type of businesses. And at the bottom, you've got the functionalities that you can attach to this data, like the PNL explained. You can explain your PNL or predict it. And if you've got all these tools, you can build on top of that a pre-trade or restricting tool or the definition of funding axes, or you can limit, you can monitor your risk limits. Okay? So, sadly, if you want to do all this, you need a lot of data. You need to store a lot of data. So that's an example of the amount of data you need in order to perform all this. So it's corresponding to an average bank, so a little bit bigger than mine, I guess. So you see that you end up with all the input and the output. You can do the calculation by yourself to something like 10 petabytes for 5 years of data. So that's enormous. So that's for the scale of the data needed to do this computation. And for the speed of computation, you need to be able to aggregate all these metrics at different levels. You can have, for example, a tree where you have your data in function of the region, then the sectors, then the counterparties, then the netting sets from each counterparties. You can also have funding sets or capital trees, because a bank is a collection of legal entities. Each legal entity has its own capital requirements. So it's a lot of ways of looking at these numbers, and you need to produce this computation in a really fast way. And because of this, you can't build an XVA system. It's just too expensive just for the sake of computing an XVA system. If you think about it, there are significant overlaps between front office, risks, and XVA modeling framework in a bank. Yes, it's coming from the recognition that whether you compute a price or XVA or you do some capital consumption calculation or ratios on any type of hardware, CPU, GPU, quantum computing, on any OS, Windows, Linux, in any mode, real-time, interactively, in batch mode, you don't need a bespoke IT system for each combination. So a better strategy is to solve this issue is to build a set of reusable but specialized components on the analytics side and to combine them at an orchestration layer using a common data format and schema for ins and out. This orchestration layer can manage each request type as a particular workflow. So each component is structured in the same way and produce results that are standardized. They can be augmented by runtime information as well. But what is important is you can mutualize the data centric task into a database and federate everything that is linked to the visualization on a common layer. So you can orchestrate all this in a common way. So here, for example, the analytics are mostly on GPUs. I'm a C++ and a CUDA developer as well. But the database can be on GPU, like Kinetica, for example, and the visualization definitely should use GPUs. Okay? So now let's discuss about what the data mask needs to do. So what are the requirements? So we saw that we had a change in scale and in nature for the data. They need to be, we need to query a massive amount of, we need to be able to query a massive amount of data. The components, the tasks running on the grid have to have access to the database in a decentralized way. So the ingestion needs to be decentralized. So we need to have a large quantity of connections. And also it has to be elastic as well, because as markets are changing, you need more data, and you need to expand the size of the database. Okay? It also needs to be compliance with cloud standards and obviously the regulatory obligations. Okay? And I invite you to look at extreme data from Kinetica. Okay? On the analytics side, which is more my job, it's the aim is to group the code base and to build all the task framework on top of this. So that's an example of how you do this. So each algorithm must be coded on the best suited OS and hardware. On the visualization side, we saw a lot of nice pictures before, so not going to show you anything, but obviously you need to be able to have access to a good visualization layer, powerful enough to sustain the explosion of numerical data. Okay, it's good to leverage the GPU as its first purpose. Okay, it needs to be also democratic and interactive. What I'm saying by interactive, it means that when, for example, you visualize what's happening in terms of XVA evolution in your bank, you need to be able to make some assumptions, to change some things, and to see the effect instantly. On the orchestration layer, so that was an important aspect of what we've done, because often orchestration is either data centric or compute centric, but it's really about being a little bit hybrid between both, and letting each task the responsibility of serializing itself or not. This should depend on three aspects: the data temporality, how long you expect to use the data, and the data locality. Data have different affinities, and you need to take into account the fact that it's better to gather them in a place where you can compute what is important for you. And the cost of storage versus the cost of recompute, which is really important for us, because there are a lot of things that are easy to recompute, and we don't need to store them. So now, how do we do the integration of the GPU in-memory database to leverage the XVA analytics? So we are going to look at that, and we are going to see, so there are different ways of obviously doing it, and I will show you how we've done it. And then we are going to look at the benefits of this integration. So we've got several choices. We can do a classic integration. So you need to imagine that the computation of the XVA is like a tree, a DAG. And you've got a lot of concurrent DAGs running on the cloud. And some of them are storing some results. Okay, so the classic integration is to say, okay, the first task is serializing its data into the database, and the last one is doing so. So that's a way of doing it. A second way is to actually enable every task to have access to the database if it's required. So we can do what I name a distributed integration. Okay, And we can do a deeper integration where actually we use the environment of the database to trigger the computation and to build the graph. So that's something that we started to look at, but it looks promising, but we don't have results for the moment. So just to go through the option do, so each starting and final task can connect to the GPU DB to save the input and the output documents. So the distribution is done easily on the cloud as XVA Analytics and GPU DB can be deployed together or separately. Each XVA task graphs are running independently of each other and concurrently. So once the result is ready, it connects to one particular GPU DB node, depending on its availability to save the data. The workload is then spread naturally on both sides. Okay? So what are the benefits? Benefits are huge. The first one is we are able to have a system that updates each time there is a meaningful change in some input. So it's quite important because you can see the effect of all your financial aggregates at the top level of the company really quickly. I think the system we are replacing is using something like 15,000 CPUs and takes 6 hours. And our last run took 3 minutes with 100 GPUs, just to give you some highlight. So for example, I'll give you an example of why it's really important. It takes, yes, I don't know if you remember the foreign exchange catastrophe on, well, maybe I don't have the time to discuss about it. But basically, sometimes you've got massive jumps in the market, and you've got the time to hedge. For example, during the CHF crisis, you had a sudden change in the price of the Swiss currency, and it was done in Reuters, and during 30 minutes, you had no change, nobody did anything, and then you had the news in Bloomberg, 30 minutes later, and then the panic started, and then the loss started to materialize. You had big changes, obviously, in the mark-to-market of a lot of portfolios, big changes on the risk, big changes on the collateral movements, then some defaults, and so on. The thing is, if you've got a system like this, you've got your change, and you've got 30 minutes to hedge yourself or to unwind some trades. On the data exploration bit, so this is a slice and dice, it's easier for you to manipulate your data and to look at particular aspects and particular slices of your data. Quickly, on the scenario analysis, so sometimes the market is changing, sometimes you can make the change by yourself. You can, for example, test interest rate increase, for example, by the Bank of England and see what is the effect on the full structure of your financial aggregates. And you can make a decision, informed decision based on that. Obviously, when you do this, you know that it has an impact on the volatility, on the interest rate volatility, so then you can change the interest rate volatility. But you know that if you do this, you need to change probably the FX volatilities between GBP and other currencies, and maybe you need to change some correlations. So you see it's a really iterative process, and for this, you need some kind of flexibility, and you need to have this interactivity between the data and the analytics. Okay, last things, which are also really important, the backtesting. We store 5 years of data, so we are able to analyze the data in the past and to do maybe some predictive models as well and to see where we can go. And to finish, we can do some optimization, and I'm working on optimization of XVA. And we are trying to find elements in the input that I described before that can be changed to minimize the cost and maximize the benefits at the portfolio structure or even at the top level structure in the bank. Okay, thank you.